a man who's held out to us in Scripture as the great pioneer of faith. His name is Abraham. Abram lived first as a city dweller in Ur and Haran, and then as a migrant nomad. He never ruled a nation, let alone an empire. And in a sense, there's a spiritual logic here. God calls the man Abram out from the Mesopotamian culture to live as a pilgrim so that he can learn the fundamental lessons of what it means to trust God. He is the paradigm of faith in God. Being one of Abram's true offspring is more than being physically descended from him. In Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abram's offspring, heirs according to promise. God has chosen that anybody who trusts God like Avram did is counted a child of Avram, of Abraham. But then we discovered that life at its highest is a relationship with God that is defined by God's word. Are humans going to trust the word of God or not? And God starts again, this time by calling out a particular person, Abram, from the descendants of Noah to form a new nation that would live life God's way. Since sin entered the world through human failure to trust God and grasping at independence of God, the way back to God will involve learning to trust Him and His Word. We can stand back from this and be encouraged that of flawed men and women, like the three great patriarchs, and Abram in particular, can learn to trust God, then there's some hope for the rest of us. That's why we have vast reams of history of Abraham and the patriarchs, because the key issue for them, in the midst of all the other issues of family and so on, the key issue was, am I going to trust God? And that will be the challenge to my heart and to yours. So where did he start? Well, we don't know a great deal about Abram's early life. But the book of Joshua tells us that Abram was an idol worshiper. Joshua said to all the people, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your fathers lived beyond the Euphrates, Terah, the father of Abraham and of Nahor, and they served other gods. That's the starting place. And we know far too little about it, really. And so speculation is rife. But at least we can ask the question, what is the nature of idolatry? Because God had to break its grip in Abram's life. Is it relevant to us? Yes, says John the Apostle. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. They may be things, forces, powers, false gods, ideas, but generally speaking, idols form that category of things that we trust rather than God. They can be things we love, though many in the ancient world feared their idols. The key thing is it has to do with trust, and so it has to do with the central message of Abram's life. There's nothing wrong with using the mind and trusting God. There's everything wrong but trusting the mind and using God. And that makes a practical difference. Now, does God not like cities? Is that what the message is? Now listen carefully in case you misunderstand me. God is very interested in cities. Just listen to this. Now, this is something you don't learn in the Old Testament. But it's an analysis of Abram's motivation given in the New Testament. I'm going to read it to you. It's in Hebrews 11. For Abraham was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. Then he goes through the other patriarchs and says, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. God is absolutely for cities. And it's not a question of which city you live in. It's a question of which city you live for. Daniel lived in Babel, Babylon. Abram left it. But the secret of Daniel's life was he lived for the city, which is what? The foundations. And now we come near to what's going on here. And life's journey was a following God as God said, come, and invited the man to leave that city on those foundations. Not to give up the idea of a city, but to think around conceptually about a totally new kind of city. Organized life, but organized around basic principles like that of trusting God. And I want to emphasize that at the beginning today, that Abram's faith was not blind. It was not based on no evidence. He'd had evidence building up constantly until this point. He had as yet no evidence that he would ever produce a child. But he had every evidence that God was trustworthy. And that is utterly crucial. That we realize that whatever the Christian faith is, it is not blind belief. It is commitment based on solid evidence. And part of it is, of course, the story of Abraham. For what does Scripture say? Abram believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. We need to be absolutely clear that works and faith are regarded as opposites. Faith is not a work. It is not a contribution to salvation. And it's this that brings peace with God, the realization that receiving salvation is not contributing to salvation. Receiving God's gift. And it was that transformed the life of Abram. But Abram was human, like we are. And he wanted to be sure. And we want to be sure, don't we? It's only when we have a secure basis for faith. It's only when we've got confidence in God that we can go out and face the world. I see that one of the basic problems is confidence in God. Because faith and confidence are very closely related. And the moment our confidence in God is undermined, we lose the central drive and motivation for communicating the gospel to the world. And so Abram raised the question, how am I to know that I shall possess it? And God didn't dismiss his request for certainty and assurance, but did something that spins up towards us through history, and is of utterly fundamental importance. He made a covenant with Abraham. And this is how God gave Abram certainty. This covenant, this agreement was like a testament. It was God committing himself to fulfill everything. And all Abraham had to do was to trust God. That's magnificent, you know. And on it hangs all our salvation, because this is how the Bible explains to us how we can be certain. What gives us stability as we face the world? It's a one-party, a monopluric covenant, a testament, as distinct from what happened at Sinai. If there'd been nothing wrong with that first covenant, not the one with Abraham, the one at Sinai, no place would have been sought for another. But God found fault with the people and said, "The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt." Why? "Because they did not remain faithful to my covenant, and I turned away from them." It had two sides, two parties. It was a diploric covenant. That's the difference, and we're all involved. It's crucial that we realize that coming down from the days of Abram, our security lies in that new covenant made on the cross, where God fulfilled the condition. And all I have to do is to trust him. And all I have to do is to trust him. When peace like a river overflows my soul. What a fantastic gospel it is. It's utterly unique, which is why the religious mind finds it very difficult to grasp, because our whole mindset, our whole education, our whole knowledge of life is you only get what you earn and what you deserve. And God comes into the situation and says, "You cannot earn it, so I'm going to do something utterly unique." You know, these are basic things, but we need to remind ourselves of them. Abram's security lies in the fact that once the covenant is ratified, it cannot be altered by any subsequent action. I think we need to take this seriously. God is the owner of this planet, ladies and gentlemen. Do you think this planet can throw its creator out and never hear anything more about him? Oh, it's big stuff, isn't it? Oh, I know there are going to be new heavens and a new earth. God isn't finished with physics and chemistry. That's old Greek philosophy that teaches that. Let's notice at this juncture, standing on the mountain, trusting God, the man is assured, utter assurance, that the whole basis is that God does us something, and all we have to do is receive it. and not earn it. It needs to permeate our souls, doesn't it? To know that we're accepted by God, quite independent of who we are, is one of the biggest things in life, isn't it? That's what keeps life stable. But now we come to the negative lesson. Abram had to learn positively what it means to trust God. He had to learn negatively not to trust himself and what the New Testament calls the flesh. The stories are obvious in a way. God has promised a child, and Sarah hasn't got a child. The text says, interestingly, and Abram listens to his wife. That little phrase occurs in Genesis 3:17 and nowhere else. This is a rerun of the fall, ladies and gentlemen. Her offering her husband the fruit where God said no. Solving the problem in the energy of the flesh, in the way in which we think is wise, retrospectively, isn't always seen to be the best thing. So they had a rough time. They had to learn about the flesh, and so do you and I. Isn't it interesting that the New Testament follows exactly this pattern? When Paul in Romans has discussed justification by faith, instead of it all leading to absolute glory and wonder, it leads to a horrific struggle inside Paul with the old flesh. And we all know about that. And we all have to learn it. We all have to learn what Paul once said. I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is in my flesh. I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. You feeling like that? You know, there's nothing more debilitating. You've been a Christian many years, and then you suddenly find you're repeating a sin. And you struggle. And the old flesh rises up, and there it goes again, and there it goes again, and you begin to despair. Do you know anything about that? Of course, we all do. Before we came to Christ and were saved, we couldn't please God through the flesh. And it's exactly the same after we come to trust Christ. And so God began to teach Abram lessons about his method of dealing with the flesh. And my, is it a bit of an uncomfortable lesson. It has to do with circumcision. We've got to face what Scripture says about it, because this is one of the angular concepts. Many came to regard circumcision and keeping the law of Moses as the means of salvation, when the very right cutting off the flesh was meant to teach the exact opposite. It was meant to indicate the abandonment of all trust in the flesh in the moral sense. Listen to this now. Here's the key verse. For we are the circumcision, says Paul, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. That is the major lesson that it was meant to teach. Every confidence in God. He believed God and it was counted to him in righteousness. But now he's got to, and I've got to learn the negative lesson. No confidence in the flesh. That's a very difficult lesson to learn. No confidence in the flesh. And the reason it's possible to do this is, again, Old Testament, Deuteronomy 30, the Lord your God will circumcise your heart. Here it comes. There is a reality that corresponds to the rite of circumcision. It is circumcision of the heart. It's not a physical ritual at all. The Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your seed to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, that you may live. You see, my unregenerate heart cannot make itself love God. If ever I'm going to love God, I must be cut loose from the flesh and planted in the Spirit. And the wonderful thing that God does when we come to trust Christ, He takes us from being rooted in the flesh and He plants us in the Spirit. And our responsibility is there ever after to walk after the Spirit and not after the flesh. Because the problem is this, that although we're no longer in the flesh, it's putrefying there, and it's so easy for us to walk after the flesh. Therefore, says Paul, as you've received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him, rooted and built up in Him and established in the faith. In Him also you were circumcised with a circumcision not made with hands. This is the circumcision of Christ. And what's it telling me? Something glorious, that when I trusted Him, a cut was made deep down in my being. That cut out that rootedness in the flesh and implanted me in the Spirit. This is a spiritual reality. And Abram entertains the Lord and His angels. That is a wonderful thing, isn't it? To fellowship with God. Things are moving upwards, up on the plateau and the mountains of his life, and he's now able to entertain God, and God comes to his tent.
The gift of life.
Abram stands in this awesome conversation. I don't really know what to make of it. Where God, the moral governor of the universe, starts to talk to a human what he's going to do about judging the cities of the plague. Let's just imagine what this is, if we take it seriously. God is inviting his comment, having an ethical discussion with this man. God discussing, dealing with our planet with a human. Is that just a little hint, ladies and gentlemen? I don't know. Abram's seed to rule the world. C.S. Lewis once said, the New Testament rustles, all its leaves rustle with the expectation of eternity. There's something big going on here, and I just feel too small to really cope with it. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? The important thing, therefore, is not exactly when he was called, but what it was that got him started on this journey. Did Abraham go in blind faith? Or was there a reality behind the start of this journey? Because this, of course, is the first great follow me in history. And it seems to me the primary thing here is this. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham. That is, it was a vision, an experience of God that impelled him to start this pilgrimage. It wasn't blind faith. It was the exact opposite of blind faith. It was a result of seeing something more glorious even than the culture of Mesopotamia into which he'd been born. That same God of glory appeared to that young man on the way to Damascus, and a light shone above the brightness of the midday sun and told him to go. And there are the two sides of our story. Abram saw the glory of God and he left that civilization to form the nation of Israel. And now Paul, listening to Stephen and being affected and eventually encountering the risen Christ, sees the same glory, and it impels the mission, the result of which is that you and I are sitting here this morning. And the major message is clear, isn't it? If ever we're going to go, if ever we're going to go on a pilgrimage that influences the world, the one absolutely essential thing is that we see the glory of God. But ultimately, we need to learn to seek God in His Word so that we hear His voice. And then we're going to have something to say to the world. We need a first-hand vision, don't we? We need to see the glory of the Lord. And you know, as you analyze Scripture, you see that anybody that did anything, anybody that did anything, was someone who'd seen the glory of the Lord. We beheld His glory. Is my God big enough to take me on a journey that's going to be significant for the world? Because it's only the glory of God that can break the grip of civilized, sophisticated idolatry. But Abram was about to discover that behind this universe, there was a person. A living, vibrant, creator person. Who had made Abram and the rest of us for himself, who wanted Abram to enjoy his love and fellowship. And who had prepared for Abram a city. The God who called then can still call now. I'd love to have known what kind of a journey it was, because from Haran to Canaan was about 21 days. And the interesting thing is, very little is said. And he built an altar and he moved his tent, and he built an altar and he moved his tent. What an interesting reversal of the normal concept of life. What have you built? Well, possibly a house or a flat. But for Abram, the tent was moved. There was no trace of it when he moved. The things that were permanent were the altars of them. That is, his life was dotted with experiences of God that were so real that he commemorated them with something utterly solid. The shifting tent, the permanency of his experiences of God. Look back over life. Do you see altars strewn through your life and dotted about? Those experiences of God that shaped you, that determined your identity, that moved you. And the whole weary way of sin up to this point in Genesis is that battle. Are we going to trust God or not? Could he believe that God could create new life? It wasn't his faith that created the life. God did that in response to his faith. And we end where we began, ladies and gentlemen. This is the truth that sent Paul to the ends of the earth for the gospel. I'm not ashamed. You? Of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. It's glorious, isn't it? Because it needs to be emphasized that trusting God is not contributing to salvation. Faith is the opposite of works. To the one that does not work, says Paul, but trusts, his faith is counted as righteousness. That gives us a message. That's worth preaching to a world whose eyes are religiously closed to the magnificent possibility that it is possible to be declared right with God. By trusting God and not relying on your own idolatrous brain. I could take you to the room in Cambridge, where as a student I first learned this, what it meant to have a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. And it opened up a whole new world to me. Because I'd often asked myself the question, in the crises of life, what is it keeps you holding on to God in faith? We talk about the eternal security of the believer. That's wonderful. But what happens if a person stops believing? We believe that God has provided for our guilt on the cross. He's provided for our character in sending his Holy Spirit and regenerating us. But what about the maintenance of our faith? And the major message of the book of Hebrews is this, isn't it? We have such a high priest. And what does he do? He ever lives to make intercession for us. And the book of Hebrews is full of encouragement to press on. Don't throw away your confession. Why not? What can encourage me to go on is this, that this King Priest is prepared to intervene in my life right now and buttress my faith to take the next step. You see, I often wondered, why have we a high priest? Isn't the cross enough? Isn't the resurrection enough? Isn't the sending of the Holy Spirit enough? Well, if we didn't need a high priest, God wouldn't have given us one, would he? That's the easy answer. Do you remember Peter? Mixed up Peter. Oh Lord, I'm ready to go to prison if I have to. And to death. And then he discovered he didn't have to. And he denied the Lord, his relationship. But before he did it, the Lord had said to him quietly, I have prayed for you that your faith doesn't fail. Didn't pray for his testimony or his witness or his control of language. They all failed. But Jesus set himself to pray for the thing that links Peter to the Lord. His faith, I prayed for you that your faith does not fail. And when you've turned again, not if you turn again, when you've turned again, establish your brother. In the journey of life, we're going to face big questions. Big decisions. And Abraham is only beginning to learn the lessons of faith. His justification by faith is the next thing in the text. But the wonderful thing is that this king, he's king of a city, Salem, which means peace, Jerusalem. And he's called Melchizedek, Tzaddik, righteous. And that preaches a big message too. You can't have peace without righteousness, you know. And we're learning to follow God's way in his city. And Abram was delivered a hard blow. And some scholars say, how could this have happened the second time? This must be simply a retelling of the first incident. But they don't read the text, because Abram makes the point that he'd made this a settled policy. He did it again. Do you know, I find that so encouraging. Have you done it again? The most debilitating thing as we seek to walk after the Spirit is when we do it again, isn't it? And this should give us courage. Just think of the experience this man has had of God. And yet he does it again. And God doesn't write him off, but lifts him up and protects him, because he has a purpose for him. And so for you, don't allow doing it again to destroy you and to hold you down permanently. We repent. Back to him, we can get up even if it happens twice or more. And we're told that after those things, God tested Abraham. It's a test. The offering up of Isaac is one of the most profound, difficult stories in the whole of Scripture. It was hard to let Ishmael go, the son he loves and whom he'd hoped would one time be the heir. Now he was to be faced with letting go his second son. It's a test. But Abram, of course, couldn't know it was a test. The one thing he couldn't know at the beginning is that he was being tested. It's the greatest test of his life. What could it mean? He who received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, "In Isaac shall your seed be called." He, Abram, considered that God was able to raise the dead. The New Testament assures me that Abram had got to the point in his thinking that if God asks me to do this, I don't understand why, because it seems to ruin all the promises. Therefore, the only logical possibility is if I have to kill him, he'll rise from the dead. Abram didn't know a hundredth of what we know in this room. Can God bring life from the death? Was the big issue circling the birth of Isaac. It now gets even bigger, the very same issue. Can God generate physical life? we will return. Is that a prophecy? Is it a despairing hope? Or is it an expression of a trembling faith? There's something so deliberate about this. A dad and his son, the dad and his son, in whom all the hopes of the planet, in a sense, are resting. But Isaac breaks the tension of silence, and he spoke to his father, Avi, my father, dad. The first conversation in Scripture between a father and a son. Dad, the fire, the wood, where's the lamb, dad? Son, God will provide for himself the lamb. What did Abram feel? What did Isaac feel? It's a turmoil of emotions that leaves me far behind. I can't begin to penetrate this. I do not know what it means that it was a ram, the father of a lamb, that was caught in the thicket. But it seems to me to underline the sheer complexity of what's going on here. It's not simply a son suffering, it's a father suffering. Oh, this is very big stuff, isn't it? I almost tremble to talk to you about it. I feel I'm on the holiest ground because time seems to collapse as we think of the other father and the other son, who went up in all probability the very same mountain together, and where the knife was allowed to come. It's our salvation. This is the gospel. This is our God. Oh, Abram, as he watched that night, as the covenant was made in chapter 15, the horror of a great darkness as God, with his lamp, went through the pieces. It was a symbol, but this is the reality. We will watch. Christ didn't go through the pieces, he became the pieces. This is the reality of which all of this speaks. Now I know, says God. What do you mean he knows? Isn't God omniscient? Now this is very important, ladies and gentlemen. Because the New Testament tells us that what happened here was that Abram was justified by his works. And that doesn't contradict his justification by faith. It is that God expects the reality of our faith to be demonstrated in what we do. You see, there's a common notion that we are justified before God by faith and before men by our works. But that isn't true. This is the paradigm incident. There were no other men there. It wasn't that men would know. It's now I know, says God. Now you can argue from now to eternity philosophically about the nature of God's omniscience. But when I read here that God says, now I know, I believe it's true. That God expects the evidence that Abram's faith is real. And God expects the evidence that my faith and your faith is real. We talk about mountaintop experiences. We should be careful. This was the mountaintop. God. God wants to know that you're real. He wants to know that I'm real. And in the end, God, in His wisdom, will test us. God requires the evidence, doesn't He? And in that sense, He was justified by His works. That is, His activity, what He did, confirmed the reality of His justification by faith. It didn't cause it, it confirmed it. And He proved that His faith was real. The man stands forever as a paradigm of what it means to trust God.
Oh God, how I need you.
You want to be real. And the grand finale is this magnificent story of a bride for the promised seed.
Laying down your pride. Wanna be someone someday.
And Abram calls his servant. And the manner of his promising shows the immense trust that he places in his servant.
You wanna have purpose inside. You wanna have virtue.
Abram longs for a bride for his son who will repeat his journey. It started with the journey. And now the cycle has come. The promised seed has been born. And now for the projected seed project to go forward, he must have a wife that will repeat his journey. And the man says, I got to go now. And it's put to Rivka, to Rebecca, will you go with this man? She's never seen her husband. But she's seen as well. This is what we're about. This is our task, like Eliezer the servant, to take the wealth of the master's son and show it to people and say, will you go? And encourage them to fall in love with someone they've never seen. Because where did Christ begin his ministry? At a wedding. John tells us he revealed his glory. So does God. And Peter says, I was called by that Lord. It got me. Has it got you? Is that what motivated you? You've seen some of the wealth. Starting the journey. So it's going to take all the millions of believers throughout all the ages to constitute his bride. And eternity will begin. I know what it's like. I don't know.